My name is Michele Poague, and I have planned several fundraising dinners and conventions, including the 2008 Libertarian National Convention, which was part of that one.
This is Eva.
Hi, I'm Eva Kosinski. I worked with Michele on the 2008 convention. By trade, I'm a retired artist. However, I spent a lot of time working with computers, so I was doing registration and data and stuff.
Hi, my name is Jenny Ojageer, and I too worked on the 2008 convention. I am a promotional products distributor, so all of those bags and neck wallets and ribbons and all promoted promotional products items are things they get from me. So I have that experience in this business.
So the first thing we're going to talk about is I'm going to assume that the people that are in this room are either thinking about having some kind of an event or working on events. So the first thing is start it today. Whatever it is you're going to do, start today. Start making your plans for it. Too soon is never too soon. You will find you will run out of time within the date comes that you want to do your event. It's really the pre-plan is absolutely as important as the day of the event. The more you have pre-plan, the more you have done before the first registration opens that morning, the better off you're going to be that day because you're going to be putting out your tires all the day of the event. Let's start with the type of event you're going to have. There are several different types of events, and there's a big difference between an event that is sponsored, where you're getting sponsors to donate money to pay for the hotel or pay for the room, whatever the venue is that you're doing, pay for the meals, things like that, and a ticketed event. As an example, we have exhibits out front here, but that is a very, very tiny part of the budget of this convention. Most of the money comes from the ticketed events. You know, we have meals and stuff that you sell, and you don't sell them at a huge profit. There's just a tiny bit in there. You need to make sure that you're covering all of the pieces of that, of putting that dinner on. And a lot of times that dinner is not just the cost of the food. There's all these good things that go into producing an event. So when you're looking for sponsors, sponsors can do a lot of things to help augment a ticketed event. For instance, we have a sponsor of C-SPAN who paid for our bags here. And these are nice bags. There is something to be said for having a sponsor that's willing to pay for a better bag, because depending on what it is that your event is, if you're doing a fundraising event for cystic fibrosis, whatever is on that bag, you want that carried around everywhere. We don't want them to take it home and put it in the closet. So in that type of event, you probably want to spend a little bit more money on those kind of promotional materials because you want them to reuse it again and again and again because you want to keep your name out there. This is one of the examples of that with this bag here has like a zipper in it and stuff, and it's really heavy duty, and it's got a shoulder strap, and you can put a laptop computer in it and stuff. So that's something that once it leaves here, it's probably going to be used in several places. So you'll see the name that you have on there, you're going to see it at Starbucks or something like that. So that's something to consider when you're choosing your event, what type of event it is, what kind of promotional materials you're going to use.
And that's information you really should share with your promotional products supplier. The person who will supply those bags need to understand exactly what it is you're trying to achieve. So often, you walk out of an event and you see giveaways in the trash, and you literally could have taken the money and put it in the trash because you wasted it. It's more important to figure out what is that item they want to keep and take home and constantly use, and you get a return on that, because they'll keep remembering your logo or your name.
whose name is on the outside, or the organization whose name is on the outside, can often be convinced to give you more money if it's going to show up in more places, and they know people are going to lose it.
So the not only pays it back, but actually give you more money, you know, that will help offset other costs. Because in a combination where you're doing a combination of sponsors and tickets, then the lower price of the ticket, the more people you can get in. It'll be important when you're doing a fundraising dinner for a candidate, because you don't want to have to charge the people that are coming there a lot of money for a dinner. You want to get them there. You want it to be enough of a draw to get people there. You want them to open their wallets when you've got them. You could do like a lot of Republican big name people. They charge $10,000 a seat, and they keep the profit, and that's the donation. Or, as we have always done, is we invite you to a really cool event, something that looks like it's going to be fun, something that looks like it's a good deal for you, and then you make up your mind at that event how much you're going to give. Maybe we don't raise as much money, but I don't know. I think it's better to have somebody willing to give it to you that way rather than pricing it so high that only elitists can come. We would like everyone to be able to come to one of our events. So I'm going to talk a little bit about when you're setting your theme of whatever it is you're going to do, whatever your event is going to be. The theme can be anything, but whatever it is, you want it to be fun. You want people to want to come to it. This is just a sample of, we just did a fundraiser for the party. It wasn't for anybody in particular, but it was a casino night. And we went all out and we got impersonators and singers. We put it in a venue where we can actually have craft tables set up and things like this. And the price was really reasonable, you know, the ticket price. And you got gambling dollars when you came into that. And then we did our fundraising later. When you're doing like a presidential dinner, you want the invitation to say what kind of event that is. This is like interesting. And when you get something like that in the mail, it's like, I have to open that just because I got to see what's inside. When we did Harry Brown, this was many, many years ago, we actually did a raised invitation because that told the people that were getting this invitation that this was a classy event. It wasn't a postcard in the mail. So you have to kind of decide when you're deciding the theme, you know, who you're going out to, who you're trying to reach, what kind of people you're trying to be bring in, and what their preconceived idea of the event is going to be. Do you have anything to add to that?
I'm usually at the end that has to do with the computers. however, there's a lot of things that you can make yourself on your computer. There's a lot more tools now than there used to be. So you don't necessarily have to go out and pay a ton of money to get things printed. If it's a small event, you know, you don't have to go and make 100 of them at the printer. You can make a certain number of them at home if you've got a half decent printer.
This is an example of something that was done at home. This is not a home computer. It's got your tissue paper in there. It's got the return. It's got the envelope. You can go to just about any place and pick up a set like this of invitations, and that tells the person that this is a really nice event, like a wedding or something. This was done on, you know, this was basically cut and paste. This was done on a computer. These are not expensive things.
But you didn't print that one.
Okay.
That one you had to take to a printer.
No, this was actually printed on my paper.
Wow.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah,
I'm impressed.
If you look really close, you'll see the lines in there. But
anybody want to
see? Yeah, so you will be able to look at some of these things. So that's when you're planning your event, you know, whatever your theme is going to be, you want to carry the theme for everything. Like, we have a theme for this, you know, legalize freedom. And you see that on everything you're doing. You'll see it on the bags, you'll see it on the badges, you see it everywhere. So that's your message for that. If you're doing a fundraising dinner for a candidate, that candidate's name has to be on everything because you're wasting your time and money if it's not there. That's what you're promoting.
And you make sure that the candidate also reminds everybody that they're libertarian.
Yeah, that's true.
end with your theme, keep it simple, because people really make it very busy. There's lots of colors, there's lots of outlines. Be careful, don't overdo it, because that does get lost.
This was from 2008, and it's a very simple phrase, and there's not a lot of graphics on there. You can see it from anywhere. And we've made mistakes both ways. You know, I've done several state conventions that where the imagery was just way too much, and people didn't even get the imagery. So it is important that you keep it simple, and that it can be made black and white, because you're going to repeat it in several places. So when you're looking at whatever your logo or that event is going to be, you do want to keep it as simple as possible. Not a lot of personal. So talk about whether it's going to be a sponsor or a ticketed event. Then the very next thing you're going to do is you're going to set your timeline out so that you know what you're going to do all the way through the cleanup. You know, set your timeline of when you're going to mail things, when you're going to sign your speakers or whatever entertainment you're going to have. You know, if it's a presidential dinner, you may not have speakers. You might have some kind of a band or something like that. And this is any event that you're going to put together. If you're raising money for cystic fibrosis or something like that, you probably will have speakers. You probably will have entertainment. You probably will have food. So you need to get all that lined out and know when you're going to order each one of those things. Then you have to find the venue. And it's not an easy thing to go in and know exactly what you need from a venue. The more events you attend, the more things that you're going to see that you probably needed or might need for your own event. I know I went to a convention that in a hotel, and when all the seminars let out and all the people were done with the business meeting, they all went into the bathrooms and were long lines. Whoever chose that didn't think about the fact that everybody would use the restroom at the same time. So those are little things that when you're choosing your venue, you want to look and make sure those things are suitable for your event. If you're having a dinner party, people want all at the same time. If you're having a business meeting, people want all at the same time. So little things like that. When you're choosing a venue, that's a ticketed event, you need to make sure that you have point that people can pass and not get behind you. You know, so you can take those tickets to ensure that you're not losing food or something to somebody who came in the wrong door. You know, not after this meal. Did you have a question?
Oh yeah, like an event like this one, how do you determine how large of a venue you want if you don't know how many people you have? Because I know you can sell tickets ahead of time, being a lot of libertarians, probably half the people signed up within the last week.
Yes, and in 2018, we made that mistake. We had no idea that that many people would sign up the day of, mm-hmm. and so we weren't prepared for that, which was even a terrible place. C-SPAN and everything, there were so many things that had to do because we didn't know. Those are things you kind of learn, and you learn from people that have done it before. So if you're thinking about doing a convention, like a libertarian convention, you talk to the people that did the national convention the years before, or you've attended them, so you kind of have an idea. This year is an exceptional year. We have a lot of people sign up at the last minute. Again, we weren't expecting them. But there's something called an early bird special. And the more you can get
sounds like you have to swallow the basketball in order to kind of do this thing. The best thing to do is to start up with small events, and then you kind of get the feel for it. And if you really want to do a big event, volunteer for the one the year before. And then you can see how all the pieces fit together, what everybody has to do, what the volunteers have to do. And that gives you a better sense of it. It doesn't help you with things like negotiating with a hotel. And I guess you want to talk to whoever the organizers for when we did last time.
And that really is not something we can go into a lot of detail in this type of event, because there's a lot to negotiating with the hotel. Everything from the AV that has to be negotiated to the room blocks. Sometimes you get a discount on food or a discount on rooms, depending on how much you want. There's a lot of negotiating with a hotel. Find a reputable hotel. There are a lot of hotels that will make you a lot of promises. If they make you a promise, write it down.
And make sure whoever made the promise is somebody who has the authority to make the promise.
That's kind of like vetting your contacts at the hotel. You have to know who the person is that has the top say. You don't want to go. You don't want to go to a maid or somebody and say, I need this. Because they may go get it for you, but they also may charge you 3 times when you negotiated that price to be. So you have to have your point person on your team and on the hotel's team. Yes. Kind of skip the team thing.
Right.
Well, I don't have that.
Yeah. But the teams are so important, and trusting whoever you're working. Because a lot of money is passing through, and you can make very expensive mistakes sometimes.
Yeah. So your team really is important. In so you have maybe one person that does like all of the AV stuff, and tell this is what your budget is as a group. You have all decided your budget for the AV is this. The budget for all of the promotional things are this. And it's your decision to get what we're going to use for that event. You're not going to step on them and you're not going to say, you know, I'm not AV, my job is to be AV, but I'm not going to tell AV person what they should be doing. I have to be able to trust them. And especially, this is really important, if you're working with volunteers, let them do their job. Because as soon as you start taking their job away from them, they will walk away. Because they won't feel they're needed. So they have to feel that it is their job and that they are. And that's really hard for somebody like me to do.
There's another issue that has to do with volunteers. I just had that thought fly out of my head, so someone else has to talk for a minute. Write it down this time.
I think you were going to say we should appreciate the volunteers and give them a thank you. So it makes them want to come back.
Oh, I know what it was. There's a warning sign. If you've got a whole committee and they're all going to be working on whatever project you're working on, the warning sign is when they start saying, I think you should do this, and I think you should do that, because those are volunteers that they bail on you to let you do. So you should find out who knows what. I mean, if you've got a techie, ask them about databases. Ask them about the things that they're interested in. Because, you know, the techie doesn't want to be talking to the speakers, guaranteed. Or, you know, use the tools that you have, and if you don't have somebody that does a certain thing, go find somebody, ask around, see if there's anybody in your organization that is good at that. And then they can shine doing what they're good at. They're not going to be trying to do something that they don't like or don't want to do just because they're a warm body. Nobody likes that.
And Jenny did touch on a point, is to appreciate your volunteers. It's one thing to, you know, say thank you and stuff. And one thing that I learned going to WorldCon events, science fiction conventions, is they always have something they call the dead dog party. That's after all the cleanup is done and all the registrations everybody's gone home. Those people that did the little things like setting up the cameras and putting the water out, the hotel, the little nameplates, all those people get together and then I'll get you together that night. But, you know, and then you're spending, yeah, you have some food for them and stuff, and you always have like that suite where the volunteers can go. It's their safe place where they can get away from the crazy speakers that are following them around and saying, my name is just fell on this, or this, you know. So they have to have a safe place, and they want to give food and water. and put yourself in their position. You're asking them to get up at 8 o'clock in the morning and probably not finish until 12, maybe 1 o'clock in the morning, working on an event like this. You know, and it's nice to think you can schedule somebody for 2 hours here and 2 hours there, but it doesn't happen that way. You're going to have that person that shines, and they're going to work from 8 in the morning until 1 in the morning. And you really need to take care of that person and make sure that they're appreciated. And a lot of times at the end of the event, you buy something special for them. Every industry gives out awards of some kind, and those awards are to say, thank you for doing the job, because we know how hard you work on that. And so awards are important.
Well, one other thing is that if you want to be sure you understand how volunteers are going to feel, be a volunteer first. Go to a big convention, be a volunteer, see what it feels like, and then you're going to know what they feel like.
One person working with the AV department of any hotel can tell you so much about AV and probably things they had no idea of walking into it just by volunteering. And an event like this, where you have so much AV, every room has speakers and microphones, you have cameras everywhere. And then you have the other outside media AV people. So you do have to have a person on your staff, your team, that is willing to go out and talk to those people. There's always going to be a certain number of people that get in for free, your comps, that you have to maintain. You don't want to give away the house to take care of a select few. Somebody from ABC comes in and wants to film your events, and wow, that's awesome. But if you let ABC in, then you've got to let all these other people in too. So you have to kind of weigh the value of that, and I'm not saying don't give ABC a comp. If they're really with ABC, I'm telling you, they won't give a comp because the comp is a conflict. And we'll know right away if they're a legitimate media person, they don't take the briefings because they can't. In most cases, they can't. But you do want to set aside certain things for them, certain spaces, you know, chairs and stuff like that, so they can sit in the bathroom. Bill and write your notes and things like that. So you do want to take care of them, but you just need to vet them. Just like you would your venue, just like you would your team. You know, vet your team. If you've got somebody that you've never heard of and they're volunteering to do something, you know, find out a little bit about that person before you start sending them a tutor. You know, they may not know what they're doing, but then again, they might know more than you do. Find out who your team members are.
It's a little easier when you're dealing with a local event and it's in, you know, it's in your own state or it's in your own local LP, because most of those people you know, and at that point you know who's going to do what they say they're going to do, and who's the one that always gets what they said they were going to do and never shows up. So that gives you a good idea. But when you start talking about a big event like this, and a lot of these volunteers will come out of the woodwork, you don't know them from Adam. You have no idea who they are or what they know how to do, and the vetting process is. I mean, you can call their chair and say, did you ever hear this guy? That might help.
Yeah, one thing I've found in doing events is you have to be careful of the professional meeting attender that have no interest in actually helping do anything. They just want to say on their resume that they helped, and they just go attend meetings, but then the day of when you really need them to do something, they don't show up.
One of the things that we have done in the past that really helps us vet our volunteers is you give them a project up front. And there are so many projects, and especially in something the size of a convention, even a state convention, there are so many upfront projects like stuffing bags, like filling out registrations, like designing registrations, designing logos. There's so much to be done up front. If that person is, like Eva was saying earlier, I think you should do that, and I think you should do that, that kind of person's not going to be your culprit. That person wants to run the show. What you really do is the person that says, I can do that, and takes it on. And then let them do it. And even if, as a team, you decide, that's not really
events versus conventions, right? So a lot of us are in the smaller, we have like no budgets, and we're trying to do events that can be profitable. And I feel like a lot of states, from what I've talked to, they have a difficult time breaking even or making a profit. So you want to do these events in order to raise money, but if you're only breaking even, it's really a loss. So can you talk about ways that you found maybe to hold fundraisers, or tips or tricks on how to know what your take home is going to be after the investments?
Yeah, I've done a lot of fundraising and small things like dinners and things like that. And there's two levels. There's your beginning level. And you can do a beginning level with no budget, and you can do something like you have a picnic in the park, and you see how many people show up, and you get 12 people. But if the picnic is fun, they will tell other people the next time you have a picnic that they'll come. So your first event probably isn't going to do more than break even, or if it does, there's just a tiny bit left over. The key to that is take that leftover and put it towards your next event, because you're going to build on it. State conventions do the same thing. They build on the convention before. If you want to continue to grow, when you're doing a fundraising event for a like a presidential candidate or a local, maybe a senator candidate or something like that, you want to build on that so you have something small and intimate the first time, and you get a couple of donations, and then you start building so that finally, maybe a month or two before the actual election, you can host it at dinner, and by then, you'll know what your price is, you'll know, have an idea of how many people are interested. And keep in mind, when you send out an invitation, and we did kind of talk about it earlier, the nicer the invitation, the more people will expect to spend. So if you're going to put it on a 3x5 postcard and mail it out, it's cheaper and you can hit a lot more people, but they won't spend as much money. So you have to decide what kind of event you're going to have. Is it going to be a suit and tie event? Or is it going to be a picnic with horseshoes and stuff in the park? Whatever it is, it should be fun, and it shouldn't be so pricey that somebody says, I'm not going to go there because there's going to be a bunch of snobs there.
Yeah, so that was my follow-up question. Just, have you found a magic number, let's say, for a dinner, maybe not like a super fancy black tie, but is there kind of like a magic number that you found per plate that people are more inclined to go to?
Yes. And that number, that cost, is you figure in all the costs of the price of your invitation. You figure in the cost of anything like this, any giveaways that you have. You figure in the price of the food, the price of the tax, the price of the tip. And that's the cost of the dinner. Now, one more thing before you get there, you have to figure in your comms. You're going to have a speaker at that dinner. You're going to be here. So that goes into that cost. You're going to have a couple of volunteers at that dinner. You're not going to charge them. Although, I can honestly say that my sister and I, all the conventions we've ever done, all the dinners we've ever done, always pay for our own tickets. You know, it's just part of what we do. But you will have volunteers that you're for if you have speakers, or if you have entertainment, you have to figure that into the cost. So you want your cost, your base cost, to be just that. And then I do like $2 over just for the, oh, I forgot this sort of thing. Figure in your AV. You know, if you're in a hotel room or something and you have to have microphones, there's a cost for that. So when you do your budget, you need to figure out every single penny you're going to spend on everything. And that's what you base your ticket price on. If you go a little bit over that for something, like $10 over that, the more tickets you sell, then you can give away another ticket. So let's say the cost of everything for the meal and everything was $70, which is pretty close to an average cost. The more people you have, the cost goes down a little bit, but not a lot. So you can say, okay, my break even on this, I have to sell so many tickets to pay for everything, to pay for my comps and that sort of stuff, so nothing's coming out of my pocket. And then after every ticket after that you're selling, you're not getting the full price of that ticket. You're only getting that cost of difference. That's where your profit is. So if your break even is 20 people for a dinner that pays for your guests, $10 for 100 people to make your $1,000 towards your event. And then you raise money at the event. Because that's really where the money really can go.
Can I just also tell you, from my perspective, with your giveaways, your promotional items, it really is important to have a good relationship with the person you work with. Because so many of my people will call me and say, this is my project, what can we do? And I will spend time working with my suppliers, looking for what's on sale, what's on closeout, what's on clearance, to make your event successful. So don't feel afraid to ask your supplier, can you find these items that are on sale or clearance? Because that helps when you're doing something like that.
An aspect of fundraising that is that organization is quite lucrative for us was as an aside to the dinner having a silent auction. The challenge of that though is that you wanted to get some really good donations very early on so that we could advertise that we've got so-and-so sports figure autographed items, free dinner coupons at some fancy restaurant, so that that became part of the marketing for the dinner. So and it was pure profit because you priced the meal to cover the cost of the meal. So anything you sell, even because it's donated, even if they pay $10 for a $90 dinner, it's still money in the bank.
And you get good marketing.
Yes, and it does make the business that you've gone to also aware of you. Mm-hmm. So you're establishing an official relationship.
And those are sponsors, and you know, don't ever discount your sponsors, but they are so important to really making your profit, and it doesn't matter what kind of event you're doing. If it's a dinner for, you look at children's hospital or something, when they put on a dinner, most everything they have has been given to them because people want to be associated with that. So those are important things.
One of the things we find when we talk about silent auctions is when people find out it's for a political candidate or for a return party, they're like, oh no, we don't do that anymore. So what are your recommendations to try to overcome that obstacle?
Well, what I find is I go to those businesses that I know that are a little bit more libertarian at heart. You'll always get no's, but if you don't ask, they're all no's. So you do have to go out and ask everybody, every business you know, if they have anything they can offer, you know, tell them what they're doing. And look at it, when we're going to businesses, we are so pro-business, so much more pro-business than either of the other big parties. So that's the way you approach that person and say, you know, I'm going to protect your business. I want to do more. I want to reel back some of the horrendous laws and stuff that are keeping you from being prosperous. So I will help you if you'll help me.
And for little things like restaurants, you know, I live in Louisville, Colorado, and we have a ton of restaurants, and all of them are constantly competing with each other. And often they'll have a back room or something that's not really getting much use, and while some of them will say, oh, it's political, we don't want to get involved in that, you're much more likely to see that from other venues because the restaurant business is cutthroat to start with. And if they're thinking butts in the seats and there's actual money coming in, sometimes you can get the room for free as long as you can guarantee them a certain amount of orders for their food. Now, that's a good way to do it because usually you've got an enclosed space that you can actually deal with without having to listen to everybody else at the sports bar, for example.
And a lot of companies will do something like a 2-for-1, and so it doesn't cost anything unless they're getting something back. So, you know, it's not just asking for free things. And ask your membership if they have stuff. Your membership has amazing things that they would be willing to donate. You know, it's something that's been in the garage forever. It's like, you know, I really don't need those stuff rackets. I've played this in 25 years. So, I'm going to clean them up, I'm going to put them in, and you know, they'll get $10, $15 for that. That's $50 you have before. And it's one of those things where you can't budget that. never had a sponsor actually put their name on an invitation. I'm not opposed to it if it's done right. You know, I will sell anything to get butts in the seat, so to speak, because the way we do our events here is when you come, you expect to open your wallet if you hear something you like. You know, we don't take the money up front and then say, oh, you know, add $1,000 a seat or something like that. And maybe somebody, if we had John Stoffel speaker, maybe somebody would pay $500 a seat. That's not the way we do things. That's just not us. So you can.
There is one watch out though, and that is if you decide that you want to have a raffle. In some states, there are some very severe laws about who can raffle. And in Colorado, for example, I think you have to apply for being the contact person for a raffle, and you have to be blessed by the state in order to have a raffle. Every state's different, so you have to check if you're going to do that. What you can do is go get little tickets like these guys that you can get at Walmart or, you know, Michael's or something, and give away stuff. And everybody who walks in the door gets a ticket, and, you know, some cool thing is sitting there, and their ticket's sitting there with everybody else's, and if they win it, they're happy. And if you can find 10 or 15 different things like that, that you can get someone to donate, that people are happy to, you know, put their ticket in.
I think I've said this before, but one of the key things about having any kind of a successful event is when people walk away, if they had a good time, they'll come to the next event you have. And you build, continuously build on what you've done previous. The first convention that my sister and I did in Colorado, we had like 80 people at that convention, which was double what the previous convention was, only because we so much more, but then it kept going up and kept going up and kept going up because people got used to, and then when we tried to cut it back, they started screaming, where is this? So, you build on, when you're doing fundraising for a party, something that I read in a book was that October is the best time to go out and ask for money, and I don't know why it is October, I couldn't tell you that, because we money for donations.
That's because a lot of fiscal financing is done at that time, like in government organizations, especially because that's the end of the fiscal year.
Very good. So a lot of times if you're going to plan an event, October is a great time to plan that event. It is right before an election too. You can do small ones that do your build up to that October event. So you can expect a little bit more. And one of the things that we did at the state party is every event we had, X amount of money off of what came in went back into fundraising. You don't spend every dime. It doesn't all go into the general budget. You have to keep building up your fundraising pile of money to your war chest. That is your war chest. That's what you're going to go out and you're going to do the next event. That's what you're going to use to put your deposit down on the next hotel. So that you're not asking somebody personally to sign their name off on a $50,000 event. You already have enough money in your party that you can do that. And it's earmarked only for fundraising. It pays for the letters that go out, and you should do letters on a regular basis. Mm-hmm. And when you're doing a letter to ask money, you don't want to ask for money first. The first thing you want to do is tell them where their money went before. Tell them what good it did. People want to join a winning cause. They don't want to be scared into, I have to give money here or else the party's going to implode. You want to tell them we're winning all the time. We did this, we did this, we did this. Now, if you give us this, it is going to go for specifically this thing. Because again, people don't want to give to a general budget. They want to know where their money's going. And that's part of the reason why we're all in this room. Okay.
One of the things that is important is, fine, get people who want to come. Say you've got a fairly large event. If you have any techies that you know who know how to deal with the dates, particularly if they can put information into a database and spit out the reports in a format, like a business card format, so that you can get little cards, or a poster format, or anything like that, you've got a big win right there, because you're not taking a little piece of paper like you used to have to do and go bring it to somebody and blow it up and do all this stuff. You do a lot of stuff yourself.
Is there any software that you recommend?
Well, but my personal favorite was my old Mac database, but they don't have it anymore.
Yeah. It really depends on what you want to do with it. I mean, yes. A database can be as simple as just using a spreadsheet.
Yeah. Right.
It's very hard to format those.
So,
well, you can merge them into letters.
Well, that's the thing. You can actually use database software to access rows and columns through the spreadsheet. And sometimes data entry is actually easier because you don't have to set up forms and all that sort of thing.
The reason I ask partly is I have an old antique FileMaker database. It was really easy for
FileMaker.
Yeah, it was really good for these kinds of things.
Yes.
And I'm in the process of I've got to replace it, so I'm shocked.
Well, I'm probably not a good person to ask because I use a MySQL database on Linux, which is not something that most people
have. Yeah, what is your comfort level?
As far as programming?
As far as tool sets, I mean, are you a Microsoft Office user?
I'm in Microsoft Office.
So you would probably be more comfortable using a combination of Access and Access. There's also LibreOffice.
Yeah,
LibreOffice
is one of the ones I'm looking at.
Yeah, I use that one because that one it can be used both on Microsoft.
Right.
Yeah. And then you have more people that you can pass back and forth with.
And PaperDirect has some good templates. PaperDirect has some good templates for doing business card layouts. And
yes.
Mailers and all too.
Yeah. And a lot of these come from like PaperDirect, where all you do is just feed it in there, and they look very, very nice. This is not a raised limitation, but the fact that it's envelope, inside envelope would be RSVP. And RSVPs are super important. Most hotels, you have to know how many meals you're selling 72 hours beforehand. We always ordered like 10% over for that. Factor. Oh, we forgot so-and-so. But you can't sell anymore after that because I would have to get make them. And the worst thing you can do to an attendee is promise them they're going to get something and they're not going
to. We had a situation with our state convention in Maine, and it's rural and lots of miles of travel. And there was an attempt this year to have a much more involved program and some entertainment and stuff. And they did an Eventbrite thing with their tickets. It was a great deal, but you know the price tag was not for the audience, and so we had to cancel about half the program before the convention. And so the pre-registrations and stuff at least saved us that issue.
Well, there's a lot of reasons why. There's usually an early bird price,
right,
and it's got a date. And then there's an extended early bird price.
The last thing you want is everybody signing up at the door because you can't order the stuff. You can't fulfill the order if you don't know how many people are there. And a lot of it you learn. When it comes to something like a dinner, the answer to the door is no. I'm sorry. But we will put you on a list and we'll make sure you get invitation for the next event. And I know I work a lot. So I don't always know if I'm going to be able to make an event. So I'm one of those people that usually it's in the last week that I sign up for something, unless I know I can absolutely change my schedule to be there.
Yeah, you said something just now that just sparked something that I never thought of. Assuming that your dinner event has a speaker, why not offer the person a reduced entry price since they're not going to be is that something that has been done?
Yeah,
something I've heard.
Yeah, we have you have your dinner seats.
Right.
And then you have your seats in the back row. And if you have a ticket, you company there to walk them in, you know, to make sure that they can find their seats and stuff. The most times that you can put an important person at a table, so everybody feels like you're sitting with somebody important, you know, especially like if you're at a convention or something and there's several speakers, and you set speakers at different tables, you want them all together. You want to spread them out so that everybody feels like they got to talk to somebody important. Those kind of, so I do like to use reservations as often as possible. And then after the dinner starts, before the speaker gets up there, that's when you open the back room for the gallery. And the gallery can come in and they can sit there and talk to you. But you can't let them in until after all the plus fancy.
On that note, how much a la carte do you guys do? So, you know, it's easier to just say, here's your ticket price, and then that's it. But then if people are like, well, I've got my appointment on this day, or if you have dinner, well, I'm a vegetarian, or I'm a student, maybe a student discount. Okay. How much do you break it down before a student?
That depends on how big a team you have and how much experience you have on it. I found the easiest way to do dinners is you always have vegetarians. I always offer a vegetarian meal, seafood or a fish, and then a red meat. And then what I do is I change the ticket so that when somebody orders something, they get a ticket for a certain color. And when they come in, they set it on the plate so the server knows what to bring them. And there's not, oh, did you have fish? That's what they paid for, that's what they get.
And those get stuffed into the back of your little gizmos here, so that.
We've had some problems with that. We have an annual dinner in San Antonio, Texas. We charge varying amounts, but usually about $100 a seat. And of course, the first time we tried to get a little bit for everybody as far as fish and all of that. We had different options, and the complaint then was, you know, you had to take the order, and no one got their food on time. It just took forever. So we decided to do one thing. And we said, if there's accommodations needed, see us for accommodations. And we just dealt with them on an individual basis instead of going ahead of time saying we have vegetarian and fish. So that one might work as well.
Yes.
What do you think?
And most places, that's what they do, is they have one plate of meal and that's what you get. Keep in mind, if you're doing a buffet generally is more expensive per person than a plate of meal. The reason why is, on a buffet, they actually have to prepare more food and end up throwing away food. So a plated meal often comes in less expensive. This is one of the things you negotiate with your hotel. And every event I've done, the first thing I ask the hotel when we're talking about meals is, can you do this? Do you understand how this works and can you do it? Because it's one of those accommodating things. And almost all hotels say they have a vegetarian option because there are so many vegetarians. It's not anymore to do a fish and a dinner. And we know ahead of time how many fish dinners, how many red meat dinners, and how many vegetarian dinners. So we give them those numbers ahead of time.
And you have a proportion for your 10% extra.
Yes,
so, you know,
proportion to what you sold.
Yeah.
And sometimes the hotel messes up. You know, and if I had a problem with the hotel, it's like, okay, you guys messed this up. I want some like gratuity back. That 18% that you're taking off the top was to do it right, not to do it wrong. And there have been times when I've had to, you know, make an exchange because there was a mix-up in the database or something like that. But those things do happen. That's your oops thing that you have to always be prepared for. But there was another question about how much do you split up a la carte and stuff. Again, it depends on what kind of meal or what kind of event you're doing. If I'm hosting a casino night like this, there's no a la carte. It's one price to come in. And if you want to buy more dollars to play with at the craps table or something, every dollar you spend on more chips is just donation. But there's one price for it. At a convention, I might have student prices that might be less, like 10% less, something like that. All of that goes into your budget.
food slowly. It isn't always just to hear someone talk that you have a dinner speaker. It keeps everybody busy while they're waiting for their food. The other thing is, when you're talking about budgeting early, think of it in terms of people who do renovations on their houses. You know, they watch this HGTV. They have this plan, it's a wonderful plan, and they get going and they're in the middle of it, and then they start saying, oh, we could add this, and we could add this, and we could add that, and then your budget goes to hell in a slip. And that's the same, you can't do that either, because you have to try and noodle all of it out together at the beginning so that you don't have to change stuff a whole lot. If you have to go ask somebody who's already done a convention and say, am I missing anything, that's probably a good thing to do.
And then, like I said, you can't start too early.
Experience with, as opposed to having a price per plate is having, like, in the lower income area where we're at, in Northwest Indiana, is having a pay-what-you-can kind of event for maybe some, have an event outside of the park where you, like, cook burgers or whatever.
Oh, yes.
And
yes.
Then just having pay whatever you can kind of thing.
I've done, for a couple of past, like, for the holidays, having a barbecue at my house, fundraiser, and they had to rent the tents, the big tents, and I had to rent some tables and chairs. And the food itself was very inexpensive because I'm not catering it. And I think the tickets were, if I remember it, were like $10. So, and if you can't afford $10 to come to the event, you're not going to be able to donate any money. But what I'm looking for is donations.
Right.
So, when I do like an engraved invitation, the reason why that's engraved is because I want the people to know that I expect money from them. This is important. And not all events are like that. This is not engraved. This is a fun event. I want them to come and have a good time. I want it to be a value. So the price of it was just the cost of actually doing the event and nothing more. Because everything else I was going to ask them to come up for money. If somebody's in a good mood, they're probably going to get money.
The other option is a potluck, where everybody brings their own food, and you probably want to check it out so that are you bringing vegetables and you don't get 27 chips and salsa.
Yeah.
I've got decades of doing these huge kind of events, and something that we keep touching on that I really want to reinforce is maintaining your database and maintaining a relationship with your database. There are big sponsors who want to see their name associated with the meat or the food that's donated or whatever. So a lot of times when I go into a lower income area, what I'm looking for is who is the natural health food owner who probably is a libertarian who's willing to donate this, and he will love to have his name associated with it over and over and over again, which goes back to what we were talking about earlier with being early is very critical, because as a business owner, I can donate something that's worth thousands and thousands of dollars to you that's going to cost me a couple $100. And for me to spend a couple $100, not only in the cause that I want, but I just got advertising for 90 days in my area. So I need you to know who I am as a business owner. I need you to be talking to me early. I need you to know how I fit into your pieces and come back to me time after time after time again, and always say thank you. One of the biggest things, I've been a business owner for over 30 years, and we donate year after year after year, and I will re-donate twice a year, and it speaks to what you said earlier, twice a year I look at my donations. Once when I'm planning budget for next year, I'm planning what I'm going to donate, and then again towards the end of the year, because I have a choice, I can donate to something or give Uncle Sam. So that's about October is when we're looking at the last quarter of the year, so that's what I'm looking at. And so if you are talking to me only in October, you're no different than my grandchild. He's coming back to me every month before her birthday, give me a wish list.
Yeah.
I'm not going to donate to you, sorry. But if you're relating to me and you're sending thank you to me and you're building those sponsor and those, then it's going to come. And your sponsors are going to invite their money back friends. So you don't have to always worry about, I only have these 10 people that have $100 each and that's it. You know, if you find the big donors, they're gonna invite their friends because they wanna go to the casino with their friends.
And so it's all about relationships.
Relationships and appreciation and follow-up is just absolute key. There's no way you can put a greater emphasis on that.
What's your thoughts on alcohol?
I like alcohol.
Yes.
If I can have alcohol at an event, I will have alcohol at an event. You have to worry about like the laws and stuff like that, especially in this day and age. So you kind of want to be careful with that. I prefer an open bar if I'm going to be asking for money, but an open bar is very expensive and you have to figure in the cost of that. If I know my people that are coming, I can kind of estimate how much they will drink. On average, you can figure 2.5 drinks per person that's going to be there. So you can figure out what the cost is on an open bar. You will have a person that has 12, and you'll have that person that has none. But it's going to average out to about that. So I'm not opposed ever to having alcohol coming. But I think that's kind of up to you.
Do you see that you get more donations or higher donations? Alcohol, sure.
There's a reason they always have those at art shows.